Well, okay. So last time we have started a discussion on the Maratha period historiography, and in that we have completed the Sanskrit text, important Sanskrit text, and now we were discussing about the text that is written in Marathi, and in that the very important literature, historical literature, we can say that has come to us is Bakhar literature. And there are a number of Bakhars that were written, especially after Shivaji's period. There are few Bakhars written before Shivaji's period, which I have already told you, like there is Hemadpanthaji Bakhar and then Mahanubhava Bakhar. Then after 17th century, large number of Bakhars begin to be written. And we'll be discussing few of them, which are considered to be important. So the very important Bakhar that we are beginning with is generally known as Sabhasad Bakhar. And that is also known as Shiv Chhatrapati Che Charitra. So, and this is written by a person called Krishnaji Ananta Sabhasad. I have this Marathi published version of this Bakhar with me, which is published by Vardha Prakashan, Pune. And this Bakhar is written by a person called Krishnaji Ananta Sabhasad. Sabhasad means member of the council, and he was the member of the council, so that Sabhasad is actually the designation, and that is what stuck to his name. And this person was having a good knowledge of southern part of India, because you know, after establishing a diplomatic relation with Qutub Shah of Golconda, Chhatrapati Shivaji has kept some of his men there on a diplomatic mission. And this person, Krishnaji Anant Sabhasad, was one of the person who stayed there as representative of the Maratha kingdom. And later on, when Rajaram became Chhatrapati and he migrated from Maharashtra to Jhinji, he took this person, Sabhasad, Krishnaji Anant Sabhasad, with him. And then he stayed with Rajaram at Jhinji. And then on the instruction of this Chhatrapati Rajaram, he wrote this Bakhar from 1694 to 97. He took near about 3 years to wrote this small text. And you know, now as it is written near about 14 years after the death of Shivaji, definitely it is based on memory. And a lot of things, there are certain things which got a bit mixed up. Let us take an overview of this Bakhar. The Bakhar is having 14 chapters, and then the writer Sabhasad mentioned that this Bakhar is written on Rajaram's order, and he gives information about Shivaji's centers, then information about the different events of Shivaji's life, then Shivaji's early conquest around Pune, and then Afzal Khan episode. That was the first major, major war between Adil Shah and Shivaji. Then Shivaji's wars with Adil Shah and Mughal. Then invasion of Jai Singh, one of the very major invasion sent against Shivaji by the Mughal. Then Shivaji's visit to Agra, his arrest and escape. By and large, we are familiar with these episodes of Shivaji's life. Then Shivaji, he sacks Surat. Then he invades south after his coronation. And then Shivaji's son Sambhaji, he runs away from his father and joins hands with the Mughal. Then forts were administered, and then he talks about death of Shivaji. So how Shivaji in general is portrayed? You know, he is portrayed as a kind of ideal Kshatriya. You know, in the ancient Sanskrit text, there is an ideal of Kshatriya, like Bhagavad Gita talks about the duties of Kshatriya and how Kshatriya should behave. Like Krishna tells Arjuna, you should not flinch from the war, and he tells him that, you know, hatova praptasi swargam jitva bhokshasi mahim. That means, if you are dying in the battle as a Kshatriya, you will go to heaven. That was one of the belief. And if you are victorious, you will enjoy this kingdom, you will enjoy the kingdom on the earth. So he says, you know, in the episode that is portrayed in this Sabhasad Bakhar, Krishnaji Ananta Sabhasad writes that when Shivaji was going to meet Afzal Khan and some of his courtier, they warn him that there is a danger to your life. And Shivaji quote this verse from Bhagavad Gita, hatova praptasi swargam jitva bhokshasi mahim. That means, how does it matter? I am a Kshatriya, and if I die in the battle, righteous battle, I will ascend to heaven, and if I am victorious, I will enjoy the kingdom on this earth. And again, Shivaji is compared to the Mahabharata hero Bhima, and Afzal Khan is, you know, compared with, by and large, the villain, not exactly villain, Duryodhana, and neither, you know, he did have some good qualities. But nevertheless, Duryodhana is by and large anti-hero, we can say. So Afzal Khan is considered to the kind of villainous character of Duryodhana, and Shivaji is portrayed as incarnation of Shiva. If you remember the concept of Maharashtra Dharma, there the people started dreaming about having their own kingdom where they can practice their own religion freely without being molested. And then Shivaji, in line with the liberal attitude of, by and large, the liberal attitude of the practitioner of Indian dharmic tradition, which is broadly speaking known as Hinduism now. And Shivaji, he gave grants to not only temple but to mosque and dargahs as well. And he talks about Shivaji's military policy, how he had a high moral values, and he had a very strict instruction to the people, to his soldier, that no woman or Brahmin or cow to be hailed. And but at the same time, Shivaji was a very clever and at the time was quite deceptive also, and that he used his deception and cleverness to expand his empire, to expand his kingdom. So Shivaji has treacherously invited the Mores of Jawi for a meeting, for a conference, and then killed him. That is mentioned by Sabhasad. And then there is a superstitious belief as well. For example, I hope this is not completed, or am I repeating the same thing? Because I teach same thing in Marathi medium also, so sometimes things get bit overlapped. Well, okay, in any case, I'll go ahead. If you feel that this
No, this is new because last class we have just discussed the Bakas about Shivaji.
last class, did we discuss this?
No,
No, na? Okay.
sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So we'll go ahead. Then, you know, in this text, Sabhasad Bakar, there was an influence of superstitious and belief that the God will punish the people if they violate the sanctity of God. And Afzal Khan, while marching against Shivaji, he breaks idol of Bhavani at Tulzapur. And then Sabhasad mentioned that episode, that when Afzal Khan broke the idol of Tulzapur Bhavani, there was a kind of voice came from the sky, Akashvani as it is called in Marathi. And the goddess told Afzal Khan, cursed Afzal Khan, that as you have broken my idol, within 21 days you will be killed. And it is after that episode, after on the 21st day, Afzal Khan was killed by Shivaji. The Sabhasad also mentions about the episodes of Bhavani entering in the, you know, Shivaji being possessed by goddess Bhavani. You know, there is a belief in some of the rural area, you still see that people get possessed either by the ghost, some of the people, and some of the people get possessed by the god, and you know, that kind of belief is there. So Shivaji is, you know, he writes that Shivaji on occasions was possessed by goddess Bhavani, and when Shivaji was in a distress and did not knew what is to be done, he used to go to that Bhavani temple, and Bhavani will enter in his body, and she will give instruction what is to be done next. As Shivaji was not aware of it, so his deputy or some assistants will write down what Shivaji said in that state of trance when he was possessed by Bhavani, and then accordingly Shivaji later acted. Bhavani entering Shivaji's body is just before Afzal Khan's meeting, and it is said that Bhavani has given him an indication that he should go ahead, he will be victorious. Well, these are the reflective of the kind of belief that people had during those days. He also mentions how Aurangzeb was feeling very uncomfortable with the gradual growth of Shivaji. So if we'll just summarize Sabhasad Bakar, Sabhasad, he gave importance to certain events and ignored certain events. As it was based on memory, some of the things he missed. For example, he doesn't mention date of Chhatrapati Shivaji's birth. The chronological sequence of some of the events are wrong. But nevertheless, among all those Bakars, this considered to be more reliable. It gives valuable information about administration and economic condition. And you know, as the author was employed by Rajaram, and Rajaram had a kind of conflict with his elder brother Sambhaji, because there was a kind of disagreement who will succeed Chhatrapati Shivaji, whether elder son Sambhaji or whether Rajaram. Some party supported Rajaram, some party supported Sambhaji. Finally, Sambhaji became Chhatrapati, and it is only after his death that Rajaram became Chhatrapati. But nevertheless, that political conflict seems to be there in the mind of everybody. And this person who was employed by Rajaram, he writes in favor of Rajaram, and he seems to be having a very quite low opinion about Sambhaji.
Yeah.
Well, now this is the next important bakhar is 91 Kalmi bakhar, a Kano Kalmi bakhar as it is called in Marathi. So it is having an entry like kalam. Kalam means one clause, second entry, third entry. So that is called kalam. For example, if you can see here, this is 12 number, this is 13 number, this is 14 number. So it is written like that. Entry number 1, 2, 3, 4 to 91 entries. However, some copies of this, handwritten copies of this bakhar were found at the place called Rairi, which is known as Rairichi bakhar, which is having 96 entry. So this bakhar is known as 91 Kalmi bakhar as well as 96 Kalmi bakhar, 91 Kalmi bakhar or Marathi or 96 Kalmi bakhar. And this is originally written by the person who served in the court of Shivaji. His name was Dattaji Trimal Vakanvis. But the original text which was written by Dattaji is lost, and later on some people they made a handwritten copies of this. So we found historian, they have found six copies of this Ekkanno Kalmi Bakhar, and out of that a copy which is done by Khando Annaji Malkare, and it was done much later, around 1720 to 1740, this period. This copy is that copy written by Khando Annaji Malkare, which is generally accepted by historian as Ekkanno Kalmi Bakhar. And this Bakhar is having again lot of superstitious and legends. This Bakhar is also translated, interestingly, this is translated in Persian language as well. And in Persian, it is known as Tarikh e Shivaji, History of Shivaji. And Jadunath Sarkar, he rates that this Bakhar is next in importance, it is next to Savasat Bakhar. And what are the content of this Bakhar is that it talks about Maloji Bhosle, that is Shivaji's ancestors. Then it talks about interesting episode of Shivaji's marriage with Jizabai. Lakhuji Jadhav, he was a very prominent Sardar of Nizam Shah. And they claim descendant of the Yadava rulers. The Maharashtra was ruled by Yadavas. And this Lakhuji Jadhav, they claim to be descendant of the Yadava ruler. And this Maloji Bhosle, he was in service of Lakhuji Jadhav. And Lakhuji's daughter Jizabai and Maloji's son Shahaji, they were children, and during the festival of Holi, they were playing color with each other. And Lakhuji Jadhav, he was sitting along with his courtier. Those Sardar, they had a kind of court like the Sultan. So he was sitting with his courtier, and then he just remarked ki these two children, like Jizabai and Shahaji, how beautiful pair it looked. And Shahaji's father Maloji, who was in fact in service of Lakhoji, he took that sentence and he said, see, in front of everybody, you have now promised your daughter for my son. And then now, as you have given your word, just a minute. Hello? So, now as you have given your word, you have given your daughter to my son, the marriage has to be conducted. And Lakhuji Jadhav, as he has uttered the word in excitement in front of everybody, he could not go back on his word. And finally, though Lakhuji Jadhav was not very happy to give his daughter in marriage to somebody who is working under him, and he had a belief that these Bhosles, they are not equal to him in any case. But nevertheless, as the word was given in front of everybody, and Maloji insisted that, as you have promised your daughter to my son in front of everybody, the marriage was conducted. And even Lakhuji Jadhav was not willing to give, but it is said that this Maloji Bhosle, he went to Nizam Shah and said to Nizam Shah that, see, Lakhoji has promised his daughter to my son in front of everybody, but now he is not following his word, he's going back. And Nizam Shah has intervened, he pressurized Lakhoji Jadhav that, as promised, you should conduct the marriage. Marriage was done, But Lakhuji was never happy that Jizabai is given to somebody's son who is working under me. Then the Bhosle's Maloji, they come out from the court of Lakhuji Jadhav, and then independently they become an important prominent sardar. Even Shahaji later on becomes a very prominent sardar of Nizam Shahi. But nevertheless, the distrust between Shahaji and Lakhuji, it continued. And then Lakhuji, he leaves the service of Nizam Shah, joins the service of Adil Shah, and then they fight against each other. Lakhuji Jadhav fight from the side of Adil Shah, and Shahaji fight from the side of Nizam Shah. So you have father-in-law fighting against his own son-in-law, even chasing him. And even at the time when Jizabai was in a family way, she has to be left in a fort, and Lakhuji Jadhav, he chases Shahaji with his army. And in that condition, Shivaji was born on the fort called Shivneri. Then Shahaji, and there was another person called Baji Ghorpade. They had a kind of hereditary enemy. And Shahaji later on, after the dismissal of Nizam Shahi, he joins service of Bijapur, and on the behalf of Bijapur, he conquered southern part of India. And now though Shahaji and Baji Ghorpade, they had an enmity, but Shahaji had one good friend in the court of Adil Shah, and that was Randullah Khan. Then the Bakhar also mentions about, so all this information is mentioned in this Bakhar. Then this Bakhar also mentions about Shivaji's conquest of Pune and surrounding area, Jauhari. Then Afzal Khan's attack, Fazal Khan's attack, Afzal Khan's son, Fazal Khan, he attacks when Shivaji was in Fort of Pannara. Then it mentions about Shaiste Khan invasion, then Jai Singh's invasion, then Treaty of Purandar. Shivaji was forced to sign Treaty of Purandar, and then Shivaji goes to Agra in 1666, and he was put in the prison by Aurangzeb's order, but then he escapes. Then Sambhaji rebels against his father, joins hands with Mughal. Shivaji gets himself coronated, then he goes on expedition to southern part of India. Then he there at Tanjavur, he have his stepbrother Ekoji ruling, and then they meet, but there is a difference of opinion. There is a conflict between Shivaji and Ekoji, and even when Shivaji called Ekoji in his camp for a meeting, Ekoji, he suspected that probably Shivaji may do some harm to him, and in the night he escapes. And Shivaji was badly hurt. He said he had no intention to harm. Then Shivaji, at a time, Shivaji's cleverness is also mentioned. Shivaji had one follower, one person working for him, called Sambhaji Kauji. And Sambhaji Kauji, due for some reason, he leaves Shivaji, and then Shivaji gets him murdered through Pratap Rao Gujar. That is also mentioned in this Bakhar. Then there is a next Bakhar, important Bakhar, that is called Chitnis Bakhar, and it is also known in Marathi as Shivaji Maharajache Saptaprakaranatmak Charitra, that is the biography of Shivaji written in seven chapters. And it is written by Mallar Ram Rao Chitnis in 1810, and this is written on the order of Chhatrapati Shahu of Satara. So this takes a lot of things from Sabhasad Bakhar. A lot of information is borrowed from Sabhasad Bakhar, then that information is elaborated. Again, this Bakhar doesn't portray Sambhaji in a good light, because the ancestors of Chitnis were killed by Sambhaji, and there is an over-glorification of Shivaji. So these three Bakhars are written on Shivaji. These are written after Shivaji's death, but these three Bakhars are considered to be important among many Bakhars written on the life and achievements of Shivaji. Now, during Peshwa's period, Maratha Empire, it expanded in all direction, and a lot of Bakhars were written during this period. For example, Third Battle of Panipat was an important event during Peshwa's period, and there are a number of Bakhars written on Panipat. For example, there is a Panipat Bakhar written by Raghunath Yadav. Then Bhau Sahib Anchi Bakhar, I have this Bakhar. This is written which gives an explanation about the Bhau Sahib's decision. Then Srimanta Bhau Sahib Anchi Kaifiyat, Holkaranchi Thaili, Holkaranchi Kaifiyat, why Holkar have withdrawn Kaifiyat. As I told you in my last class, that Kaifiyat is generally, it gives a kind of explanation for the behavior of the hero of the Bakhar. Holkaranchi Kaifiyat gives an explanation why Holkar was compelled by the situation beyond his control to withdraw from Panipat. And then there was a person called Kasiraj Pandit, and he was in the court of Nawab Shuja-ud-Daula, and he wrote Panipat Achi Bakhar. And you know, this is in fact he wrote in Parsi. This is an English translation of that small Bakhar which is written by Kasiraj Pandit. Now, what the Bhausaibanchi Bakhar consists, let us have a little bit of discussion. So this makes an analysis of Maratha defeat. There was in the northern India, there was rivalry between these two Maratha prominent Sardar, Shinde and Holkar, and the atmosphere, political atmosphere, how it has undergone changes before the Battle of Panipat, how Nawab of Aodh, the Rohilas, the Rajputs and Jat, they turn against Marathas and they join hands with Ahmad Shah Abdali. Bhausaheb Peshwa, the commander of Maratha army, which marched to north to meet the challenge of Ahmad Shah Abdali, how he had made certain diplomatic mistakes. He could not keep the Nawab of Aodh and the Rajputs and Jats with him. He had certain disagreement with Holkar. Holkar was the war veteran, very experienced person, and Holkar advised to Bhau that let us fight the guerrilla war. We are expert in the guerrilla war. Let us not go into the frontal coalition against Ahmad Shah Abdali, who is a very well-known and seasoned warrior of his time. And Holkar also advised that we should keep all our, non-combatant and women who accompanied the army at Bharatpur. But Bhausaheb did not listen to him. And, you know, he had certain disagreement with Holkar, and that probably became one of the reason of decision in the Maratha army, and finally leading to the fatal defeat on the Battle of Panipat. There were, and he describes very vividly how the Marathas, who were very enthusiastic in the beginning, you know, as they marched towards north, they went on conquering and they were very enthusiastic. Just before the Battle of Panipat, Bhausaheb Peshwa has won the war at Udgir against Nizam, and he was very confident. And but slowly, how that confidence and enthusiasm turned to despair, because Ahmad Shah Abdali was much more seasoned than Bhausaheb, and he knew how to tire his enemy and then finally attack them to ensure the success. And then there were chaos in the camp, as Maratha camp were surrounded by the Afghan and they were not getting adequate food. And then Maratha defeat at Panipat, and how survivors, they were escaping, they started running. And the extent of damage the Panipat has done to the Maratha Empire is narrated in this Bhausaheb Bakhar. Now, we will just sum up a little bit about Bakhars. So most of the Bakhars, they use the material that is handed over from generation to generation in the oral form. The reliability is obviously questionable, but it does reflect about the opinion of the Bakharkar about their heroes. There is a superstitious, there are legends, there is a liberal use of exaggeration, the dates are inconsistent, names are sometimes confusing. And Rajwade, who was under the influence of the positivist school, believe that this is, please remember the word positivist. You know, I'll give you explanation when we talk about positivism, but I just want to bombard you with this kind of technical terms, so that at least it will remain in your mind what is the meaning of positivism, so that when we talk about positivism, your understanding will be better. So, you know, the narration is quite fragmented. There is some certain contradiction. There is a vague vagueness. It is vague at a place, and it is unreliable also. So, you know, Jaddunath Sarkari is having a very low opinion about Bakhars. He said that it is a collection of gossip and tradition, sometimes no better than opium eater cell. Of course, this is a bit exaggerated, but I'm just telling an opinion of an expert historian. Now, let us talk about the next important source of Maratha history, historiography written during this period, and that is this text, that is Agyapatre. And this is now edited and published by Professor A.R. Kulkarni, and it is published by Diamond Publisher Pune in 2007. And, you know, originally it is written in Marathi. I think I have shown you the Modi earlier. So this is Modi and this is Devanagari Marathi, in which we generally write Marathi nowadays. So in that way it is published now. And lastly, there is an English translation of the whole Agnyapatra also, which was done much I think in 1920s before independence. And this translation is done by Professor Puntambekar, which was done in 1929. And this was first published in series in Journal of Indian History, and now it is published in the form of book. So About Adnyapatra, we will talk about author, what does it contain, and then little bit of analysis. The author is Ramchandra Panta Amatya, who was elevated to the position of Hukumat Pana. You know, he was during the period of Rajaram, you know, just before that, Chhatrapati Sambhaji was caught and killed by Aurangzeb, and Rajaram became Chhatrapati. But as the Mughal, they were invading Maharashtra and they also attacked Raigad, the capital of Maratha, Rajaram, he escaped from Raigad and he took shelter in Jinji, as I have already told you. So the war, but the war has to be continued. You know, Jinji, the war at Jinji, it continued by Rajaram when he was assisted by Santaji and Dhanaji, two prominent cavalry commander of the Marathas. And from Maharashtra, the situation was administered and managed, and the war against Mughal, it was monitored by a person called Ramchandra Panta Amatya, and that is the reason he was given the title of Hukumat Pana. Hukumat Pana means as good as the next king. And this person had an experience of working for Shivaji, Sambhaji and Rajaram, all these three important Chhatrapatis. And later on, after Rajaram's death, Tarabai, Rajaram's wife, she became the head of the Maratha Confederation. And but then after 1707, there was division in the Maratha Empire. The descendant of Sambhaji, Shahu, he started ruling from Satara, and descendant of Rajaram, they started ruling from Kolhapur. So he was in the service of Kolhapur, and there was another Sambhaji, Sambhaji II, who was ruling from Kolhapur. He was son of Rajaram, and he was this person, Hukumat Pana, Ramchandra Panta Amatya, he was in the service of Kolhapur, in the service of Sambhaji. And then on the instruction of Sambhaji of Kolhapur, he wrote this text, Adnyapatra. And this text, it contain it gives information about the policies followed by Chhatrapati Shivaji. Hukumat Pana or Ramchandra Panta Amatya, he mostly worked from Vishalgarh. And you know, little bit of about his life, his political career, that he you know, Santaji and Dhanaji, these two important Maratha cavalry commander, they had differences which had proved little costly for the Marathas. Santaji was finally killed. Ramchandra Panta Amatya, he tried to resolve the differences between these two. In 1715, this text was written. Some historian or some scholar like V.B. Kolte, they believe that the author of this text, Adnyapatra, is not Ramchandra Panta Amatya. And Jiddunath Sarkar also believes that the person who claims to be contemporary of Shivaji, this text doesn't seem to be written by a person who was contemporary of Shivaji, and he doesn't give much importance to this text. But Shejwalkar believes that the text is written by Ramchandra Panta Amatya. See, one of the argument that is given by V.B. Kolte is that in this text, Ramchandra Panta Amatya, he speaks that Shivaji was against giving Jagir, but Ramchandra Panta Amatya himself was having a huge Jagir. So the person who himself is having huge Jagir, how can he write that Jagir was discouraged? So, you know, there is a bit controversy, as it happens many of the handwritten texts that came down to us. It's difficult sometimes to ascertain who is the author, but nevertheless, many people accept that this is the text of Ramchandra Panta Amatya and gives us a very valuable information about the administration of Shivaji. So even if you consider that this is the text of, by Ramchandra Panta Amatya, we should be aware of the controversy surrounding the authorship, right? And let us, I hope everybody is from English medium. Is there anybody from Hindi medium? Let me know. Well, okay. I'll switch over to bilingual, otherwise I'll continue in English. Now, this Adnyapatra is having 9 chapters, and what the different chapter contains, I will tell you in short. Chapter 1, it gives information about Shivaji's policy and achievement, what was the condition of Maratha state at the time of Sambhaji's accession, Sambhaji's policy, Aurangzeb's invasion, and the effect of his invasion. Then chapter 2, it gives information about condition of Maratha kingdom when Rajaram became Chhatrapati after the death of Sambhaji. What were the policies of Rajaram, information about the forts, cavalry, infantry. The author, you know, he also talks Rajaram crossed Narmada and invading northern India, which seems to be a bit exaggeration. We are not sure that Rajaram had done that. The general principle of state policy and organization, that is in the third chapter. It elaborates on the function of the king, his routine, how the king should be protected, what kind of entertainment that the king should allow. You know, it says that the king should not mix with the people who doesn't have a class. I mean, the people of whose behavior is of not of good standard. He should not joke with everybody. The king should maintain the proper behavior. He should consult his minister. The financial policy, military policy, different weapons were used. The qualities of servants are mentioned, and how prince should be educated. Chapter 4 talks about the administrative and ministerial policy. Remember that all this is about how Chhatrapati Shivaji has ruled. Then king's public function, the importance of minister, the qualification of minister, the king's policy towards his minister, what are the different functions of his minister, and relationship between the king and the minister. Chapter 5 talks about commercial policy, and you know, it gives a lot of importance to merchant. Like it says, merchants are ornament of the kingdom. What are the policy Shivaji followed towards merchant, and the character of foreign European merchants and their political ambition. You know, Shivaji was a very clever person who understood that the Britishers are the people who are very ambitious. They will proceed very slowly, but once any land comes to in their hand, they will never leave that land. So Shivaji was very, you know, according to Annapatra, Shivaji understood the political ambitions of this European power. Then in the sixth chapter, what are the policy should be followed towards Watandar, that is elaborated. Watandar were the traditional right holder. You know, they traditionally had certain rights over the certain area. So it talks about their characters. They are very greedy for land. They are always, you know, trying to encroach on the land of nearby Watandar. They had some internal fraud. Who will succeed to Watandari? For that, they used to always fight. They have a tendency to join enemy. You know, if enemy promises that their Watan will be protected, they will leave their present king and join hands with the enemy. What policies the king should follow towards them? You know, it should be balanced, but they should be kept under the strict watch. Then chapter 7, it talks about hereditary vrittis and inam. So vrittis and inam, they are the again traditional ownership. You know, the land, in particular land, the certain people, they had certain rights. So he said that they not to confiscate those kind of traditional right of the traditional right of the some people, but no new vrittis and inam should be given. And the land may be given for religious purpose, but it should be given to a very carefully selected person. Then chapter 8, it talks about the construction and organization of the fort. It highlights the importance of the fort. The forts, you know, they are like key to the controlling of the surrounding area, and they can be a foundation for the further conquest. How the forts are to be organized and administered. The Watandar in the region surrounding the fort, they should be posted away from the Watan. And the garrison on the fort should be always active. There should be adequate provision of water. And near to the fort, there should not be very high hill. Otherwise, the enemy can mount cannon on that hill and fire on your fort. So if the fort is to be constructed, ensure that that is the only top hill. Even if there are surrounding hills, those needs to be destroyed. The officers, they need to be frequently transferred. Otherwise, on the one fort, they may, you know, develop a vested interest. If Kiledar join hands with the enemy, his children and wives to be enslaved. That is one of the tricks that he mentioned to keep Kiledar loyal to the king. Then chapter 9, it talks about naval policy. It talks about how the ships are to be constructed, different size of ships, and how the navy is to be organized, what kind of policy to be followed towards merchant ship. The ships are to be sheltered at different places during the rainy season. If the ships are going to same place every rainy season, because rainy season the ships cannot sail in the sea. It's difficult because sea it becomes very troublesome during rainy season, and there is a threat of the ship getting drowned. So the ship are to be sheltered at the same place in on the seashore, but every time the seas, the ships should not be kept at the same harbor, because the sailors may start troubling the civilian population. They may go to their agriculture land, cut the trees, or bring something, or snatch something. And again, during harbouring of the ship during monsoon season, care should be taken that sailors and soldiers, they are not troubling the local population. The trees on their agriculture land are not to be cut. And even if you need wood for the cooking and you need wood for the ship, you must take permission from the people, pay them adequate money, and then cut the tree. And the only old and dead trees are to be cut.
करेक्ट
Well, so if we have to summarize this Agyapatra, we can say that there is a bit of exaggeration here also, but nevertheless, it is an important source of the administration. Let us talk about next important source, that is Shaka, next important historiographical text that is written during Maratha period, and that is Shakavalis. In the Shakavalis, we find the chronological order, chronologically, the day. You see, date is mentioned here, and the important events are mentioned here. So among the Shakavalis, this is again written in the Modi text, this is a modern day Marathi. So among the Shakavalis, we found Jedhe Shakavali. This is a Shakavali of Jedhe family, and here important events happening in the family is given, but as the family was involved in the political affairs, it gives us information about the important political event as well. As it follows the Shaka calendar. The Hindu traditional system of having a different calendar, Shaka and Vikram Samvat. So it is done according to Shaka, so it is called Shakavali. So there are different Shakavalis like Jedhe Shakavali, Shakavali of Shivapur Kardesh Pandey, Gadadhar Prahlad Shakavali. So Jedhe Shakavali, it was found by Bal Gangadhar Tilak in 1906-7, and it's having only 23 pages. Copy original was never found, and it gives important information about the historical event in the 17th century and participation of Jedhe family in those important events. It starts, interestingly, it starts with history, it starts with birth of Aurangzeb and the siege of Mughal to Fort of Jinji, ends with siege of Mughal to Fort of Jinji in 1697. Jedhe, I think I'll try to close this because otherwise this small topic will be left. There are certain information which this is I'll be uploading on the Google Classroom. You can read it, but it talks about the important event like Afzal Khan, expedition of Afzal Khan, then Malik Amber, revolt of Prince Khurram, birth of Shivaji. Then during Afzal Khan war, how they joined hands with Shivaji and did not listen to the order of Adil Shah, sacrifice of Baji Prabhu Deshpande. Then Aurangzeb destroying temple at Banaras. It talks about Shivaji's coronation. Shivaji's there. So I have just listed out the important information. You can just go through. I don't think there is any need of explanation. It will become repetitive. So the Shakavalis are important because it fills the gap. So here we end about the historiographical text written during the Maratha period or Maratha historiography. So if you are having any doubt, you can ask me.